Harper Audio presents The Incorrigible Children of Ashton Place, Book 4, The Interrupted Tale, by Maryrose Wood. Performed by Katherine, Kellgren. The first chapter. A Swanburn Girl Thinks of Home. At the Swanburn Academy for Poor Bright Females, birthday parties were cheerful but brief affairs. They took place at breakfast in the dining hall over bowls of hot porridge. It was customary to offer the birthday girl an extra helping, which was generous but hardly necessary, as porridge is rather filling to begin with. Small gifts were permitted, as long as they were the humble sort that the girls could make themselves, such as knitted neck scarves and monogrammed handkerchiefs, and, of course, the ever-popular pillows embroidered with the sayings of the school's founder, Agatha Swanburn. But after the porridge had been eaten, the presents opened, and a round of, "For she's a credit to Swanburn, for she's a credit to Swanburn, for she's a credit to Swanburn!" And so say all of us, had been rousingly sung. The party was done, and all the girls, including the birthday girl herself, were shooed off to their lessons straight away. Remember, a sound education is the very best present of all, Miss Charlotte Mortimer, the headmistress, would say, clapping her hands to signal an end to the festivities. Off you go now. Don't forget to clear your plates. Clap, clap, clap. Nothing unkind was meant by the brisk efficiency of these celebrations. There was simply a great deal to learn, and limited hours in which to learn it. As Agatha Swanburn herself once remarked, so many cupcakes, so little time. An unfortunate mathematical ratio that remains in effect to this very day. Miss Penelope Lumley no longer lived at Swanburn Academy, of course. She had graduated more than a year earlier, and was now a professional governess in the grand house known as Ashton Place, currently the home of Lord Frederick Ashton and his excitable young wife, Lady Constance. The historically minded among you have doubtless heard of the Ashtons. In Miss Lumley's day, they were known for their immense wealth and sprawling estate, including a vast and mysterious forest in which some unusual things had been known to happen, but more on that subject later. With its manicured gardens, countless elegant rooms, and a fleet of servants tending to the house and its residence, Ashton Place was a far more luxurious setting than the Swanburn Academy for Poor Bright Females could ever hope to be. Even so, on this particular autumn morning, Penelope found herself feeling rather homesick for her alma mater. She missed the hard wooden benches and chilly classrooms in winter, for there was rarely enough wood to keep more than a modest fire going in each hearth, even on the coldest days. She missed the long march from the dormitories to the dining hall every morning, during which the girls bellowed the school song with great feeling and even greater volume in order to wake themselves up. She even missed the porridge, which, to be frank, was sometimes lumpy, especially if one let it get cold. Most of all, she missed the birthdays. For although the parties were short and lacked cake, and the presents were homespun and predictable, to Penelope's knowledge, never had any Swanburn girl received a golden locket from a secret admirer on her birthday, or a magic lamp with a wish-giving genie inside, or even a sweet-tempered pony to spoil and train and make one's best friend forever and evermore. Still, at Swanburn, when it was your birthday, everyone knew it. The day began with gifts and a song, and there were friends close at hand to share jokes and make a fuss. Even the sternest teachers and the brash older girls with whom you hardly dared to speak smiled at you in a special knowing way your whole birthday long. Nevertheless, it is my birthday, even if no one knows it but me, Penelope confided to her bedchamber mirror as she readied herself for the day ahead by brushing her hair into its customary neat bun. I am 16 years old, at last. Curious, she examined her fingers and wiggled her toes. At 16, they seemed no different than before, nor did the mirror show any evidence of transformation. her drab dark hair, her clear grey-green eyes, her brow that was prone to furrowing in deep concentration, especially when there was a mystery to be solved, all seemed unchanged by the momentous nature of the day. Yet a page on the calendar had turned, and here she was, 16. To Penelope, it sounded quite grown up, never mind that she spent most of her waking hours in a nursery full of toys, which was understandable since she was, in fact, a governess. Now, some of you may be tempted to feel sorry for Penelope, for what could be sadder than to have a birthday that no one knows about? Recall that she was not without companions at Ashton Place. She was on cordial terms with Mrs. Clark, the head housekeeper, and was equally fond of Margaret, the good-hearted and squeaky-voiced housemaid. There was no question that Penelope was liked and admired by all the household staff. Even so, in Miss Lumley's day, to be a governess in a grand estate was a lonely job. She was not counted among the servants, for she was an educated person and had no household duties other than tending to the children. Yet she was in no way the equal of her employers. She was rudely ordered about by Lady Constance and could be dismissed from her position with a word. In short, in a world where a person's place in society was either high or low, Penelope was somewhere in between. It made it difficult to feel real friendship with anyone, at least in the free and easy way she had once had with the girls at Swanburn, where one poor bright female was no better or worse than any other. For this, and perhaps some other reasons, the people to whom she felt closest at Ashton Place were her pupils, Alexander, Beowulf, and Cassiopeia Incorrigible, the three wards of Lord Frederick Ashton. The children had been found barking and yapping in the forest during one of Lord Frederick's frequent hunting expeditions. Their puppyish behaviour was a consequence of having been raised by wolves, although, as Penelope had discovered, they may have had some human help as well. The Incorrigibles adored their Lama-woo, as they called her, little howling awoos often snuck into the children's ways of talking due to the wolfish influence of their early years. But they were still children, which was not quite the same as Penelope having friends her own age. In any case, she was much too kind-hearted to have told the Incorrigibles about her birthday for one simple reason. She did not know when the children's birthdays were, and neither, she assumed, did they, and she would never want to hurt their feelings by drawing attention to that fact. After all, an uncelebrated birthday is not nearly as bad as never having a birthday at all, she thought. Poor Incorrigibles. It would be terribly unkind of me to make a fuss about turning 16, given the circumstances. Still thinking, she closed the door of her bedchamber behind her and headed toward the nursery. Anyway, presents can be such a nuisance, all those bits of torn wrapping paper to tidy up. And if one does not get presents, one does not have to bother writing thank you notes, which saves both time and ink. As you can see, it was Penelope's nature to try to cheer herself up when feeling glum. No birthday cards means no danger of paper cuts. No cake means I will have a good appetite for supper. And no birthday candles greatly reduces the risk of accidental fire. Really, I am quite lucky to be spared all that bother. If there is anyone for whom one ought to feel sorry, it is the children. Even if they did know when their birthdays were, I am quite sure the wolves in the forest would not have had the slightest notion of how to throw a decent party. Eureka! For those of you unfamiliar with the term, Eureka is what to exclaim when you have discovered something worth shouting about. It was an ancient Greek scholar named Archimedes who first shouted Eureka. He was in the bathtub when it happened. Coincidentally, his discovery had to do with how water in a bathtub rises when an ancient Greek scholar is bathing in it, and how measuring this displaced water would be a foolproof way to find the volume of said scholar, should anyone need to do that. Bear in mind that this is advanced mathematics. Most of us will never need worry about the volume of old Greek men in the bath. What is important is that shouting Eureka is both enjoyable and a spur to productivity. Try it for yourselves. You will discover how peppy it makes one feel to do one's math homework when there is a bracing cry of Eureka to look forward to at the completion of each problem. Eureka! Penelope exclaimed again, for her idea was truly an excellent one. I will organize a birthday party for the children. Since there is no way of knowing when their true birthdays are, I shall simply declare today to be the incorrigible birthday and do all of them at once. 1, 2, 3. It will be a wonderful surprise for them, and pleasant for me as well. For this way, there will be cake and singing anyway, and I doubt I will miss being given any more handkerchiefs, as I already have so many. With her lip quivering only a little, for the thought of those sweet monogrammed handkerchiefs made her even more homesick for Swanburn than before, Penelope opened the door to the nursery. "Children, rise and shine. You will never guess what today is."
"Tuesday?"
Alexander jumped up and blocked her way into the room. Still, she was able to get a glimpse of Beowulf at his desk, chewing on some object that he quickly hid in his pocket. "No, it is Thursday," Penelope replied, squeezing past. "Where is your sister?" The boys looked down at the floor, up at the ceiling, and sideways at each other, everywhere but at their governess. The howl of pain came from the back nursery, where Penelope found Cassiopeia in her bed, whimpering and thrashing to and fro. "Cassiopeia, what is it? Are you ill?"
"Very ill."
The girl squeezed her head with both hands and waggled her tongue from side to side.
"Tummy ache, and I have a headache,"
Beowulf added, crossing his eyes.
"We are all sick. I am dizzy, see?"
Alexander tottered about the room, spun in a circle, and fell to the floor. Then he gazed up at Penelope and croaked,
"Highly contagious. Plague, perhaps?"
Penelope helped the boy to his feet. "I doubt it is plague, but I hope it is not the chicken pox."
"Chicken pox!"
Beowulf strutted around the room and flapped his arms like wings until his brother shot him a look. He clutched his leg and moaned in agony. Penelope frowned. "I thought you had a headache."
"In my leg, I do,"
Beowulf explained,
"from chicken pox."
He hopped on his one good leg and made chicken noises. "Muck, muck, muck, muck."
"Tummy ache,"
Cassiopeia wailed.
"In my nose."
Then she buried her head under a pillow from which some sort of unidentifiable, repetitive, smothered sound, weeping, sneezing, giggling, could be heard. Penelope looked around the room and considered this unexpected turn of events. The children were acting strangely, to be sure, but perhaps it was because they were sick. In any case, it was obviously not the right day for an incorrigible birthday party. No party. Her disappointment swelled, and she permitted herself one small, melancholy sigh before saying, "Our topic of study for today is poetic meter, but there is no point in doing lessons when you are all so sick. I presume you do not feel well enough for breakfast." The children's eyes gleamed with hunger, but all three shook their heads. "That is too bad, for I believe the kitchen baked fresh biscuits this morning." Penelope waited for some sort of reaction, for the children dearly loved biscuits, but three stoic faces avoided her gaze. "Very well," she said, not wholly convinced. "Stay in bed, all of you. I shall go ask Mrs. Clark to summon a doctor." Penelope found Mrs. Clark in the pantry inspecting bags of flour for beetles. "The children are not feeling well," she said, trying not to look, for the thought of bugs in the flour threatened to put her off her own breakfast. "Alexander is dizzy, and Cassiopeia is in bed with a tummy ache. Would you be so kind as to have the doctor called?" Mrs. Clark dug into each bag with a tin flour scoop and a sieve.
"The doctor? For a child's tummy ache? Nonsense. I'll send up Margaret with a hot water bottle, some castor oil, and a nice big spoon. Hold the bag open, would you, dear, while I snoop around for weevils?"
Penelope obliged, although she was not wearing an apron and the flour made white streaks on her skirt. "Beowulf is also ill. He claims to have a headache in his leg."
"In his leg? Well, that's peculiar. Got one?"
Mrs. Clark crushed the bug between two fingers and flicked it to the ground. Penelope winced. highly peculiar, I agree. That is why I would like the doctor to examine them. A sip of brandy will dull the pain. Anyway, it's not the end of the world to let them suffer. Builds character. Look, there's another weevil right there. She squinted at the tiny intruder. We'll have to sift this whole batch. To suggest that sick children ought to be left to suffer in order to improve their characters seemed quite unlike Mrs. Clark, whom Penelope knew to be thoroughly kind-hearted. Then again, Penelope had never asked her to summon a doctor before. Perhaps there was more to it than she realized. "If you say so, Mrs. Clark," she replied cautiously, "but if they get any worse, I will have to insist that you reconsider."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.